Okay, maybe we should get started. Today it's my great honor to introduce Mohamed Anber. Mohamed, I think did his PhD at UMass Amherst, is that right? And then went on to postdocs in Toronto, University of Toronto, and then at the EPFL in Lausanne in Switzerland. And then spent several years in Portland at William and Mary College. I'm sorry, Lewis and Clark, I apologize.
Lewis and Clark, yeah.
College. Very recently, earlier this fall, moved to take up a position as a faculty member at Durham University in the UK. And Mohamed will tell us about some really cool recent developments and understanding of the global structure of the standard model and its implications. So go for it, Mohamed.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for the invitation. So today I will be talking about the global structure of the standard model and new nonperturbative processes. And this talk is based on this paper with Eric Poppitz. So let me start actually my talk with a take-home message. And feel free to leave after this slide if you want. Basically, I'm just summarizing what I'm gonna tell you about today. So everybody knows that the standard model of particle physics is based on the Lie-algebra of SU3 cross SU2 cross U1. What is less appreciated, however, is that up to now, we don't really know the global structure of the gauge group of the standard model. It is still an open question. So it is given by this G sub n, which is SU3 cross SU2 cross U1 modeled by Z sub m, where m could be anything. It could be 1, 2, 3, or 6. We don't know which one of them is our standard model. However, it turns out that if n is equal to 2, 3, or 6, then the standard model accommodates new fractional instantons on a closed four-dimensional manifold. And these new fractional instantons will mediate the baryon number and lepton number violation processes.
Mohamed, yes. Can I ask you? So this, so 1, 2, and 3, and 6, this is generation number independent, or this is for three generations?
This is, right, thank you for the question. This is actually generation number independent.
Independent, okay, thank you.
Right. All right, what happens if M4 is R4? What happens in the decompactification limit? I have to be frank with you, and I tell you that in the decompactification limit, we don't really understand these new fractional instantons. So I'm afraid I cannot say much about the R4 limit. Also, it turns out that this new fractional instantons will not play an important role in phenomenology or cosmology unless the standard model contains extra matter that is charged under the U1 hyper. So basically, this is a summary of what I want to tell you today. So this is the outline of my talk. I will start with a general review of a recent topic, which is the higher form symmetries. Then I will explain how that the standard model accommodates one form global symmetry. Then I will be talking about gauging the one-form symmetry, and gauging this one-form symmetry will give rise to new fractional instantons. And the immediate applications of the new fractional instantons is lepton number and baryon number violation. And I will very briefly comment on the cosmological implications. Throughout my talk, I will be mentioning M4, which is a closed four-dimensional manifold. And for all practical purposes, you can think of T4, the fourth torus, as the prototype background manifold I will be concentrating on. So let me start with a general review of the topic of higher form symmetries, because I want really to make use of it in the standard model. And to explain what I mean by a higher form symmetry, let me start with zero form symmetry. And in particular, I will start with a zero form global symmetry. This is what everybody knows from the 101 field theory. This is a local symmetry, basically. So consider some field phi, under this zero form global symmetry, phi transforms under some representation R of some group G. So phi transforms like R of G times phi. So this is just a global symmetry that acts at the field on the field phi. So it's a point-like particle. You can think of phi is basically a point-like particle in this case. An example of G is could be abelian U1 or an abelian SUN, or could also be discrete Z sub N. And we all know that if G is continuous, then there will be a conserved Noether current that satisfies the following relation, partial mu J mu equal to zero. Or if I want to write it in a fancier way, I am going to write it as the D star J1, where J1 is a one-form current. So you see here the association. I'm talking about a zero-form global symmetry, and there is associated the one-form conserved current. So we all know this construction. What is new, though, is that we can actually associate the action of the group G to a three manifold. This is due to the work of this group. So what we exactly we do is as follows. We can actually take our current and integrate over a closed three-dimensional manifold inside our four-dimensional manifold. And mu here is just a unit vector perpendicular to M3. Or I can write it again in a fancier way as the dual of J1 over our three-dimensional manifold. And this integral basically equals to the charge defined on this manifold. After defining the charge, I am going to define this operator U sub G, which we call a symmetry defect. So I can define it for unitary operation. I can define it as follows. It is e to the I alpha times Q, where basically alpha times Q will be associated to a group element little g of the group big G. Now I am going to also demand that this symmetry defect U satisfies what people call the fusion rule. So if I take U that corresponds to the group element G1 and I fuse it with U that corresponds to the group element G2, this will be equivalent to U of G1 times G2. So basically this fusion rule gives you the group product rule that we all know about from group theory. So you might ask, okay, what actually this buys to us? In fact, this it might be important way to construct a symmetry defect of a discrete group like Z sub N, because we know that a discrete group doesn't have an Noether current. Yet, using this abstract construction, we can talk about the symmetry defects associated to Z sub N. In this construction, however, it is very important that M3 is being a topological surface. What this means is that all the correlation functions I am talking about cannot depend on the geometry of this manifold M3. All right, now I also want to write one more algebraic relation, which will be extremely important. Let me define the following operator V, which is defined to be e to the I phi. So again, this is a local operator. And let us see the relation between U and V in the following sense. Let me try to move V past U. If I try to do that, I will acquire an element R of G. So this element actually depends on the representation. I can draw some picture of this relation as follows. This is my U, this is my symmetry defect, my M3 here can be taken to be, for example, S3, the three sphere, which surrounds my local operator V of P. Of course, if I move V of P inside the surface, nothing happens. If, however, I try to move V of P past the surface, then I will acquire this element R of G. So this is basically the vectorial expression, the picture of this expression here. Why I am saying that? Because this is actually going to be important for the generalization of this structure when I talk about one-form global symmetry. And the one-form global symmetry will be important for the standard model. So what is the one-form global symmetry? By analogy, a zero-form global symmetry is a symmetry that acts on local operators. And the one-form global symmetry is actually acts on extended objects. So in this case, we are talking about charged objects, which are Wilson lines. These are one-dimensional objects. And in this talk, I will be concentrating on Wilson lines in U1 and SUM. So we define the Wilson lines in U1 just by taking the gauge field A and just integrating it over a closed contour, which could be the circle S1. And also S1 will be taken to circle one of the cycles in my four torus. Physically, sorry, the Wilson line, yes, please.
I have a question about this four torus. So if you're going to apply it to the standard model, that means you have to make sure that the size of this torus is huge. Is that right?
Very good question. Actually, I'm going to comment on that and talk about that in great details.
Oh, okay.
But
that's what you're assuming, right? You're assuming that space-time has some structure which is compact and with large dimensions, right?
Not really, okay. As I mentioned, unless the torus is extremely, extremely small, okay. I mean, in general, I could actually take my torus to be whatever. Yes, for the construction, whether it is small or large.
Oh yeah. For the construction, I agree. But when you have the applications to the standard model, you're going to have to assume some size, right?
Very good. Right, and this depends on the time I am interested in the standard model. In other words, whether I want to find some applications now or in the early universe.
Oh, okay.
Yes, because I, yeah. So
okay, thanks. On, yeah. Sorry. Yeah. See you. Yeah. Sorry.
It's okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks for the question. Very good. All right. So back to the Wilson line. Wilson line physically is a probe charge, okay? Here, because U1, I am talking about, is compact U1, so all the charges have to be integer charges. And the Wilson line here corresponds to the probe N equal to one charge, which is basically the fundamental charge in this case. So I'm talking about a fundamental Wilson line in U1 electromagnetism. So again, the Wilson line is charged, but is charged not under a zero form, but rather under a one form global symmetry. So this is a U1 one form global symmetry. And now you might ask, what is the corresponding Noether current? And one actually can find the Noether current by just looking at Maxwell's equations. So I will start with the free Maxwell's equations, partial mu f mu nu equal to zero. Or again, I can write it in a fancy way using the differential form. So in this case, actually, I can associate a conserved current to the field strength of electromagnetism. So basically here, in this case, no other current is exactly equal to the field strength F. And now I'm going to build my symmetry defect U. Again, by taking the Hodge dual of J2 and integrating now on a two-dimensional surface, M2. And of course, this U will correspond to some element G e to the I alpha, where alpha is some phase between 0 and 2 pi, again, because I am talking about a compact U1 electromagnetism.
Could I ask a quick question? So,
yes,
mu of F mu is 0 if you don't have any currents, right? Like normal other fields charged under the Stern model, right? So typically you would have a right-hand side, right? The electron current instead of 0, right?
That is correct. That is correct, right. Yes, I'm going to mention that. Yes, I will come to that. But here I'm just talking about free Maxwell's equations, and then I'm going to introduce dynamical charges, right?
Okay.
All right, thank you. So, but what is the Hodge-dual J2? Hodge-dual J2 is just the Hodge-dual F2, which is basically the electric field. So basically, this symmetry defect operators just measures the electric flux lines through this closed surface M2. Basically, this is just a Gauss surface. Again, I'm going to write the following fusion rule between symmetry defects corresponding to two elements, G1 and G2, exactly like before. And now I can ask myself what happens if I surround the Wilson line by this symmetry defect and I try to move the Wilson line past U. If I do that, I'm going actually to acquire a phase e to the I alpha times the linking number between S1 and M2. So this is again a phase in U1, and I get back the W times U. So this is the algebra that is satisfied by U and W. But it's extremely important here that all the surfaces I have are topological. So U and W have to be topological. And this is why I have to use free Maxwell's theory. Let us see actually what happens if I introduce the dynamical charges into the game. I think that this was the previous question. So let us assume now I put the right-hand side not equal to zero, but I introduce some electric current, and I'm going to introduce the electric current that corresponds to the n equal to one dynamical charges. In other words, let me actually introduce the fundamental dynamical charges into the game. If this is the case, then one actually can see that we don't have well-defined Wilson lines. Why? Because these Wilson lines will be screened by the dynamical charges. One easy way to see it is as follows. This is Wilson line. It carries some U1 flux. Again, let us not forget that these are fundamental Wilson lines. So they carry the flux of a fundamental probe charge. But n equal to one also carry the exact same flux of the probe charge, which means that this flux that is carried by the Wilson line can be completely absorbed by the dynamical charge, which means that the dynamical charge can actually screen the Wilson line. So in this case, I don't have a topological operator. Wilson line is no longer topological. And in this case, I cannot even talk about a one-form global symmetry in this case. This is why I had to start with free Maxwell's theory. Yet I actually can evade this problem as follows. I prohibit n equal to one. I prohibit the dynamical fundamental charges. And I allow for charges with n bigger than one to be there. In this case, the flux that is carried by the fundamental Wilson line cannot be absorbed by n equal to two dynamical charges. And in this case, I have topological Wilson lines. So in this case, I can still talk about topological lines, and I can talk about one-form global symmetry.
Mohamed, can I just check something? I mean, the things that are topological are the symmetry generators, which are defined on two surfaces. The Wilson loops or lines are basically almost never topological except in TQFT, right?
Well, actually, in some sense, also they are topological in the sense that they should not, all your computations should not depend on the geometry of both W and U. Of right, so this is exactly this relation here. Sorry.
No, the correlation functions of the one-form symmetry generators with Wilson lines have to be topological, yes. But the, for example, the expectation value of a Wilson line is not at all topological, right? I mean, it depends on, there's a perimeter law contribution, there could be a Coulomb contribution from Coulomb exchanges. This is not a contradiction to your formulas. I'm just a language thing, maybe.
Well, you see, actually, I mean, I just, by topological here, I mean that this phase here depends only on the linking between S1 and M2, right?
I completely agree, yes. So that correlator is topological with respect to moving the...
Exactly.
Moving the symmetry generator, yes.
Exactly. So you cannot even talk about this linking if the dynamical, if n equal to one dynamical charges are there.
That's right,
so, I agree. So this relation even doesn't make sense at this level.
Yes.
Yeah, thanks for the comment. So the upshot here that if the dynamical charges are present, then I can no longer talk about one form global symmetry. So this is the main shot, the upshot here. All right, so the next Wilson line I would like to talk about is Wilson line in SUN Bjur-Young-Mills. I will start with Bjur-Young-Mills for the exact same reason I started with the pre-Maxwell's equations. But here, okay, instead of having a U1 one-form global symmetry, we have a ZM one-form global symmetry. So the symmetry here is valued in ZN instead of U1. So we are going to define our Wilson line again in the fundamental representation as before, but A1 here is a non-abelian gauge field. And again, I can write down the following algebraic relation between U and W, but now U, the symmetry defect, is designated by an element of Z sub N instead of U1. And again, I can write down this relation here, and the phase here, we see that it is valued in ZN, exactly like in Maxwell's theory. And instead of writing this very long relation from now on, I'm just going to write that under Zn, W1 acquires the Zn phase. Again, for the exact same reason, okay, I cannot talk about a one-form symmetry if the dynamical matter, okay, is in the fundamental representation, for the exact same reason I mentioned before. Again, this is a Wilson line in the fundamental representation, which means that it carries the flux of the center, okay? But if this is a fundamental quark, then in some sense that this fundamental quark can absorb this flux of that is carried by Wilson line, and hence this Wilson line will be screened due to the presence of the dynamical matter in the fundamental, and I can no longer talk about a ZN one-form global symmetry in this case. This actually is going to be important for the standard model. So this is why I had to start like this. Any questions? So far, more questions. All right. Now I would like actually to explain that the one form, that there is a one form global symmetry in the standard model. In order to do that, let me just very briefly review with you the standard model content. So we have a left-handed quark doublet. We have a left-handed lepton doublet, and we have a right-handed electron, a right-handed up quark, right-handed down quark, and Higgs doublet. These different fields have the usual charges under SU3, SU2, and U1 hyper. Notice here, however, that I choose a normalization such that the U1 hyper charge of all the fields are integers. In the textbooks, actually, the charges, the U1 hyper charge is 1/, for example, for QL is 1/6. So here I'm just multiplying everything by 6.
So could I ask a question here then?
Yes, please.
So you're just scaling the U1 hypercharge, but you're not.
That is correct.
But you're not embedding the hypercharge into a SU5 where the scaling would be different.
That is correct. That is absolutely correct. I'm not embedding.
So does that mean then that are you assuming 3-2-1 is just the same gauge group all the way into the UV, right?
That is correct. That is correct. Because, right, because if I actually assume gut, then, okay, I cannot say that there is a one-form global symmetry in
yeah,
the
that
sense
was my
of
question.
SU3
yeah.
cross SU2 cross
okay,
U1.
Okay, yeah,
yes,
yeah, that was
correct.
My question. Okay, yeah, thanks.
Yes.
Yeah, okay, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. All right, very good. So also the matter content actually have the standard U1 baryon and U1 L charges. So these are standard. All right, so how I'm going to argue that there is a Z6 one-form global symmetry in the standard model. There are actually different ways to show that. And here I am using the language of Wilson lines that I just talked about. So what actually I'm going to do is that I'm going to define a Wilson line that is called the curly Wilson line here. I'm going to define it or build it from three Wilson lines, W1, W2, W3, that are associated to the U1 hyper, SU2, and the SU3. In general, I will show you that this curly W is charged under a Z6 one-form global symmetry. And after that, I will also show you or prove to you that this curly Wilson line cannot be screened by any of the standard model particles. And if this is true, then this means that indeed the standard model accommodates a one-form global symmetry. So let us see how I'm going to build out this curly W from W1, W2, W3. So W3, again, this is the Wilson line associated to the SU3 gauge group. And in principle, there would be a Z3 one-form symmetry X on W3 by a Z3 phase. Similarly, I can talk about W2 associated to the SU2. And in this case, also, there would be a Z2 one-form symmetry that acts on W2 by a Z2 phase. Now notice the following, that the least common multiple of 2 and 3 is 6. This inspires me to use the W1, the Wilson line that is associated to the U1 hyper. And let us actually recall that U1 hyper can correspond to different group elements. And I'm going to take the Z6 element, the Z6 subgroup of U1, exactly for this reason, because LCM of 2,3 is 6, which means that when I take this group element to be a Z6 subgroup of U1, W1 will acquire a Z6 phase. So in general, this curly Wilson line that is made out of W1, W2, W3, in general, will actually be charged under a Z6 phase or a Z6 one-form global symmetry. So now I constructed my curly W. And now I want to show you that this curly W cannot be screened by any of the standard model particles. Here I'm going to give you an example with the quark doublet. And you can do the exact same exercise for the rest of the particles. So the quark doublet, the left-handed quark doublet, lives in the fundamental of SU3, in the fundamental of SU2, and it has a charge Q equal to 1 in my normalization under U1 hyper. Because QL lives in the fundamental of SU3, then I can say that in principle, QL actually has a Z3, or in principle can absorb a Z3 flux. Okay, this is basically the center of SU3. It can also, in principle, absorb a Z2 flux, and this is in the center of SU2. And because I am using the element G, which is Z6, the subgroup of U1, And because this quark has charge equal to one, it will also, in principle, it can absorb a flux, Z6 flux in U1 that corresponds exactly to this group element here. However, when you multiply these three phases together, you get one, which means that this W, curly W, which in general carries a Z6 flux, cannot be screened by QL. Sorry, I am having trouble with, sorry for that. So this W, which carries in general a Z6 flux, cannot be screened by QL because the phase here is equal to one. You can actually repeat the exact same exercise for the rest of the particles and convince yourself that none of the matter content of the standard model actually can screen this curly W. And this means that this curly W, this means that actually the standard model accommodates a Z6 one form global symmetry. All right, any questions up to now?
So earlier you said that if you were to embed, if you were to imagine that there's some grand unified theory, then you wouldn't have this symmetry. Can I?
Right.
Is it because in any grand unified gauge group, this would-be symmetry is gauged, or is it because it's explicitly broken by the presence of some
heavy It is states? Explicitly broken, right. This G6 is explicitly broken by some heavy gut particles.
Okay, instead of being gauged.
Exactly, it's not gauged.
Okay, good. And
it's explicitly broken, right.
Okay, I see. But then these screening effects would be very mild for loops that are not too big.
That is correct.
The particles are extremely heavy.
Right, right. Yeah, okay, still you can talk about emergent, in this case, Z614 global symmetry, if you are below the TEV scale, right. Gut scale, sorry, if you are below the gut scale.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. All right, very good. So far I was talking about global symmetries, but the next question is gauging a global symmetry. So how we are going to gauge this Z6 global symmetry, and the gauging is important because gauging will give rise to the fractional instantons. So in order to do that, let me just review very quickly how we gauge a zero form symmetry, and then I'm going to talk about gauging a one form symmetry. So let us start with gauging a zero form symmetry. So in the case of the zero form symmetry, we have a corresponding Noether current. And one way to implement the conservation law of Noether current is to introduce a background gauge field. This is A1, such that under the action of G0, A1 transforms as A1 plus D lambda zero. So this D lambda zero is the gauge transformation, which includes both small and large gauge transformations. This is the first step. And the second step is to sum over the gauge bundles of this background gauge field A1. So this is the two-step procedure. But summing over the gauge bundle also amounts to summing over topological charges that are made of the gauge field A1. So here the topological charge can be is equal to F, which F, and this F is basically given by this expression here of the gauge field A1. So the point here is that these topological charges Q are always integer. Whenever we gauge a zero form symmetry, we always sum over sectors with integer topological charge. This is very important. The very famous example, yes, please.
All right, just to check, I mean, normally we would put a theta in front of that term, right? Instead of a one. There would be theta.
That is correct. That is correct. But what actually I wanted to say here that, I mean, in In other words, actually, a better way of writing this this z is just to say that I have to sum over all, like, right. So something like that. This is what you mean, over all sectors, I theta q, right, times whatever, e to the is, right?
Correct.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Very good. So a very famous example, which actually, I mean, very relevant to what I'm going to say, is if you take g equal to su2, and in this case, the large gauge transformation of lambda zero will correspond to what we call the BPST instantons, which basically interpolate between the different Brie vacua, as we all know. And these BPST instantons have well they have well understood solution even in the case that M4 is equal to R4 in the decompactification limit. So in the case of SU2 of the standard model, one can also write down an Itov vertex that corresponds to this BPST instanton, which includes an amplitude. This amplitude actually depends on the action, and this action is 8 pi square over G2 square, where G2 is the coupling constant of the SU2 sector. And also, we have four fermion zero mods in the background of these BPST instantons, three zero mods coming from the left-handed quark, and one fermionic zero mod coming from the left-handed lepton doublet. So for example, this Itov vertex will give rise to a baryon number violation, delta B equal to one for a single family, for example. And of course, we all know that this has important applications for baryogenesis. So this is gauging a zero form symmetry. What about gauging a one form symmetry? Now we're actually going to repeat the exact same procedure. So in this case, again, I told you that there will be a conserved noether current. Oh, sorry, again. There is some technical problem here. I'm sorry for that. Okay, so I'm going to repeat the exact same procedure I talked about before. So there, for the case of a one-form global symmetry, there is a corresponding two-form noether current, conserved noether current. And in order to implement the conservation law equation, I can introduce a background gauge field, but in this case is a two-form gauge field, B2. And I will also demand that under the action of the one-form symmetry, B2 will transform as B2 plus D lambda one. Now, I'm going to do the second step, which is summing over gauge bundles of this background gauge field B2. And again, this amounts to summing over sectors with topological charges Q that is made out of B2. And in this case, it turns out that this topological charge is in general fractional. And this will distinguish gauging a one-form symmetry from gauging a zero-form symmetry.
So, sorry, so what is this B2? I mean, so what are the quanta of this B2? Are they the, I mean, previously the quanta of the A1 was just the massless gauge bosons, right? So what happens here with this B2?
All right, okay. So actually, if you just could wait for two slides, and this actually will be a bit more clear when I talk about the explicit construction of this B2.
Oh, okay, thanks.
All right, so up to now, I must say that up to now, this is in some sense, some kind of like some abstract structure, all right? But I'm gonna actually, I mean, put some flesh and bone in it, and I'm going to write down the explicit solutions of this fractional topological charges.
Oh, okay, thanks.
All right, so, as I mentioned that in the standard model, we have a z-sex global symmetry. So we might actually gauge z-sex or a subgroup of it. So of course we can gauge either z2, z3, or if you take n equal to one, this just means that we don't gauge anything. Okay, we don't gauge any of this one form. We don't gauge any subgroup of this one form symmetry. And this explains why I told you that in general, we could have four distinct standard models in nature. So because in principle, you could gauge the Z6 or Z2 or Z3, or you don't gauge anything. And this gauging actually is or amounts to modding the SU3 cross SU2 cross U1 by Z sub n. Again, n could be 1, 2, 3, 6. Why gauging amounts to modding is requires some explanation, but basically modding by Z sub m amounts to identifying the center elements of SU3, SU2, and U1. And this identification actually can be thought of as coupling the standard models to some topological quantum field theory, which give rise to this background gauge fields B2. So this is just in a nutshell, what is the relationship between gauging a one form symmetry, in this case, the Z6 or Z sub n in general, and this modding of the gauge group. So in the following, I will concentrate on gauging the full Z6, okay? So gauging Z2 or Z3 subgroup of Z6 follow the exact same rules. So let me just concentrate on the gauging of the full Z6. So in this case, I will be talking about the G sub 6 standard model, which amounts to modding by this Z6. Now, in order to do that, I will argue now that you need to introduce three background fields. As I mentioned, in order to gauge some F1-form global symmetry, you have to introduce background gauge field, and then you have to sum over it. But here, because I, in order to construct this curly Wilson line, I have to use W1, W2, W3, okay, that corresponds to three distinct phases. This means actually I have to introduce three background gauge fields, what I call the B1, B2, B3. And now these B1, B2, B3 are of course two form fields and they have to satisfy a quantization condition. So if I take, for example, B1 and I integrate it over a closed manifold M2, then I have, I will get a 2π/6. And the same thing, for B2 and for B3. And again, please notice that this quantization condition is in one-to-one correspondence with these phases I talked about before. By the way, okay, this M2 could be thought of as a T2 torus that is a subgroup of our four-dimensional torus, for example. In addition to that, because as I mentioned that the standard model of particles, the particles of the standard model are blind to the combined fluxes, as I gave you the example before, then actually these background gauge fields have to satisfy a constraint. So there has to be a constraint between B1, which is the background gauge field of U1, and B2, the background gauge field that corresponds to SU2, and B3, the background gauge field that corresponds to SU3. So in a nutshell, in the standard model, when we gauge the Z6, which amounts to summing over these background gauge fields, we actually have to sum over all the charges, okay, in this case, Q1, Q2, Q3, and these charges are the topological charges that corresponds to B1, B2, B3. And in general, these are fractional charges. So we see that Q2 is 1/2 plus an integer, Q3 is 1/3 plus an integer, and the Q1 actually it is given by this expression here. And as you can see here, there is 1/2 and there is 1/3 and there is N1 and N2. N1 and N2 are generally are two integers. And this relation actually stems from the fact that I just told you that the background gauge field of U1 hyper or that corresponds to the U1 hyper, B1, is constrained to be the sum of B2 and B3. Okay, I must admit that this construction has been a little bit abstract. And maybe actually now I come to Tony's question about what are these things really? So in the following, I'm going actually to construct these solutions explicitly on the four torus. So I'm going to give them bones and flesh so you can make sense of them. So in the following, I'm going to construct them self-dual or anti-self-dual instanton solutions on T4 with fractional topological charge. And I hope that by this construction, it will be clear actually what these fractional things are. So the way I'm going to do it is to try to embed this B2 in SU2 as follows. So again, this S2 means that the action that corresponds to the SU2 gauge group. So we know that this is the general action. And now what I'm going to do is just, I'm going to use the Bogomolny completion trick. So I can write this action as 8 pi squared over G2 squared times the topological charge plus this term. And this term can be set to zero if I have solutions, in instanton solutions that are either self-dual or anti-self-dual. So they satisfy F is equal to plus or minus F tilde, where F tilde is the dual field. So if this relation is satisfied, then this term here is zero, and the action will be proportional to the topological charge. But now I claim that I can actually construct a solution with fractional topological charge, Q equal to 1/2. And this is the explicit solution on T4. So here, for simplicity, I'm going to talk about asymmetric T4. By symmetric, I mean that the torus has the exact same length in all the directions. And also, I'm going to set the Higgs wave to be equal to zero. This is important because, as I will mention later, we don't really know the solution when the Higgs wave is non-zero. But at least this is a solution. So how I'm going to construct this solution? As you can see that the solution is proportional to the tau field direction. And I'm going to take A1 to be proportional to the X2 coordinate and the A3 to be proportional to the X4 coordinate. And I'm going to set A2 and A4 equal to zero. Now it is a simple exercise to see that this gauge, the field strength that results from this gauge field solution is constant over the four torus. So F is constant over the four torus, as you can see simply by taking the derivative. And you can also compute the topological charge of the solution. As we know how to do it, we just compute the integral of F, which F divided by 8 pi squared. Again, this F is just is dA, okay, plus A comma A, but A comma A is zero because I am taking a solution that is proportional to tau 3. So if you compute F, you just find this dA, and then you compute the topological charge, which is Q, which is F, which F divided by A pi square. And in this case, you'll find that this is equal to 1/2.
So these are solutions that you found, or they were previously in the literature?
They were previously in the literature, actually. They were actually found originally by Itholt. Ah. So here we are, we just used them.
Is this what he calls torons?
Exactly. These are the torons.
Oh, these are the torons. I see. Yeah.
Okay. Right. Yes.
Okay,
thanks. Yeah. Yeah, I mean Itholt could have saw that back in the 80s when he found these solutions. Yeah, but for some reasons, it wasn't like appreciated.
I see.
All right, very good. I can actually now do the exact same exercise for SU3 and for U1. So for SU3, we find that the charge is equal to 2/3. And for U1, we find that the charge is given by this expression here for arbitrary integers N1 and N2. One thing I mentioned about these solutions that they are self-dual or anti-self-dual, why this is important, This is important for the stability of these solutions, because I want to make sense of them when I sum over them in the path integral. And they have to be stable in the sense that there should not be negative modes in the background of these instantons. Otherwise, they are not legitimate instantons in the sense that I cannot sum over them if they were unstable. But thankfully, they are stable. And this stability is attributed to the fact that these are self-dual or anti-self-dual solutions. The solution I just showed you is the solution on the symmetric T4. However, it is easy to relax the symmetry, the symmetric condition. And one actually can show that there exists there exists exact self-dual solutions if instead this condition is satisfied if L1 times L2 is equal to L3 times L4. Again, this actually was found first by Itoft, and then Van Bald made use of it in order to study the stability of these solutions. However, if L1 times L2 is not equal to L3 times L4, one can still find approximate self-dual solutions as expansions in a parameter X, which is given by L1 times L2 divided by L3 times L4. The drawback of all these solutions, if you want to call it a drawback, that all these solutions are not localized in the sense that they are constant on the four torus. So if I can like draw a picture, so basically they fill in the full T4 torus. This is what I mean by not localized. The field strength is constant over the four torus. And as I will mention, actually, this have implications or problems for cosmology. So let me summarize. So I argue now that actually, if you are talking about the G6 standard model, then what we actually should do is that you should sum over all instantons, both fractional and integer instantons. So let us now see what is the implications of the existence of these fractional instantons. So we all know that U1 baryon minus U1 lepton is a good symmetry. However, U1 baryon plus U1 lepton is not a good symmetry. So let me now write down the Itoff vertex that corresponds to both the fractional instantons and to the usual BPST instantons. So in the case of the fractional instantons, the amplitude of this Itoff vertex is proportional to the sum of the actions S1, S2, and S3. These actions, in the case of self-dual or anti-self-dual solutions, are proportional to the fractional topological charge. But also, in the background of these fractional instantons, there will be zero modes of the different matter contents of the standard model. And the number of these zero modes can be computed using the index theorem, which gives an integer I1 through I5. So this I1 through I5 just counts the number of the zero modes. On the other hand, we have our usual BPST instantons with the given Itoff vertex as I explained before. And the question is, what is more important, okay? The question is whether the fractional instantons can actually be more important than the BPST instantons. But what we are comparing, yeah, please, go ahead.
On the previous slide, actually.
Sure.
How do you think about this Itoff vertex that you wrote? Because I can understand how to derive an Itoff vertex operator for a localized instanton.
Right.
But here it's totally delocalized.
So that is correct.
What does this mean? Yeah, what does it mean?
Very good, all right. Actually, this was what I was about to just mention in the next slide.
Okay, so, sorry.
But let me just mention one thing, maybe partial answer to your question is that, in fact, okay, I mean, in order to write this iterative vertex, you don't need more than the index theorem. Whether your solution was localized or not, actually, this does not, the number of the zero modes does not depend on this fact.
I mean, I agree with you that there is an index theorem and that there is a sense in which there are some, that index theorem, I mean, when we want to use at hoofed vertices, what we like to do with them is basically exponentiate them by thinking about some dilute gas approximation.
Right.
And then exactly. The extent that this at hoofed vertex operator is local, you get local particle interactions, which are then interesting, especially in this case, because they give like baryon decay and whatever. But if the vertex itself is just like badly non-local, then one might worry about how to do that next step, which of course you probably have, we'll discuss later.
Very good, all right. Very good question, all right. And the frank answer is that it is not clear, okay, to me how to localize these solutions.
Right, right.
But I want to, yeah, this first. But the second thing I would like to argue that maybe there will be some mechanism, okay, by which you can actually localize the solution, but the answer in the end will not depend on all these details.
Okay.
Why? Because as you can see, actually, this iterative vertex depends only on the amplitude and on the number of the zero modes. Mm-hmm. The amplitude depends on the action, and I can actually argue that the action might not depend so much on whether actually you have localized solutions or not. So as long as the action is small, so in some sense, you can apply the dilute gas approximation in this case.
Mm. So maybe one way to phrase that, rephrase that, sorry to have interrupted again, but—
No, please go on.
One way to rephrase that maybe is like as a conjecture that the full solution, the full BPS solution contains something like a size modulus, but you don't really know the details of all the moduli of the solution. So what you found is like a particular point in the moduli space, which corresponds to a completely delocalized solution because that's easy to find. But perhaps there's some parameter in the full solution that one can dial that can take you from this completely delocalized thing to something localized. And then
which
it would be more akin to the usual instanton, right? Because the usual instanton also has a size zero mode. And you should only really take it completely seriously to the extent it's a small instanton and so on. But
that's correct. But
like it's maybe a conjecture that there is such a thing.
But actually, notice here that because I'm taking my torus actually to be really small, I'm actually going to talk about that because my torus is really small up to now, as actually I will mention, because this is in some sense self-consistent thing.
Okay,
so
very,
I'm thinking
very
it
good.
To be really small.
Okay, good. I'm excited to hear more. Okay, thank you. Please go on.
Yeah. Okay, very good. I'm going to discuss this just in a minute. So back to, okay, to your question also, maybe like, this is like, exactly. Here actually what I constructed is some solution on T4. If I want really to compare BBST instantons versus the fractional instantons, I should actually compare on the background first that corresponds to zero temperature. This is like to start with. And then maybe we can increase the temperature and see what happens. But first of all, we have to compare the fractional instantons and the BBST instantons at zero temperature. The solution I showed you, okay, is a solution on T4, which does not correspond to zero temperature. So what actually I should do is that to find solutions, not on T4, but instead on T3 cross R, which correspond to zero temperature and then compare. Unfortunately, I don't have solutions on T3 cross R. However, I would expect that the solutions or the actions of the solution on T4 will not differ much from the action of the solution on T3 cross R. One can actually imagine a situation where you can just take one of the directions of this T4 and you make it actually very large compared to the rest of the directions. And this would be this setup T3 cross R without affecting the actions too much. Again, I don't have a proof, but I would expect that this would be the case. So assuming that the solution I just constructed on T4 will have the same action of solutions on T3 cross R. I'm going to do my comparison. So here T3 is taken to be, again, a symmetric T3 with some length L. And this length L is going to work as a cutoff, an IR cutoff on my physics. So I'm going to take this L, the length of my three torus, to be bigger than the TEV scale. To be bigger than the TEV scale, and I'm going to set the Higgs the Higgs div to be zero. So everything is consistent. And now I'm going.
Sorry, can I ask a question here? So I have to make sure I follow. So, so previously you said that you're going from the four torus to T3 cross R. You could just take one of the lengths of the torus just to infinity and you can get that limit. But are you saying that you can't do that because you've only found symmetric solutions?
Right. We don't know the explicit solutions on T3 cross R. Right.
But is it because you don't know solutions with all the lengths of each tori are different? Is that really the?
That is correct. Right.
I see.
Right. We don't know.
So the only solution you have, the only solution you have is with T3 symmetric, just one length for all circles.
Actually, with the T4 symmetric.
Yeah. Sorry, T4 symmetric. Yeah.
Yes, that is correct. This is the only solution we know.
I see.
Okay. Yes. If you don't take them to be symmetric, then you have to actually appeal to some approximate iterative solutions. But even this construction is not fully actually developed up to now.
Okay, thanks. Yeah.
Even the name instanton would not apply, right? Instanton means that it would be kind of localized in time, right? So it's some tunneling solution around certain tunneling time. But if your solution is constant in this T3, and it would be like a constant background field, right, throughout all times, right? So if I naively take your statement of T4, that you have a solution that permeates all torus, right? If I deform it, if it still permeates all the torus, and then it's some sort of constant in time background, right?
But wait a minute, unless you can actually find a solution that is localized on T3 cross R, in the sense that you can actually find what actually I have in mind, maybe actually you can find a solution that is localized in time,
okay,
but unlocalized in space.
But this is pure conjecture at this point, right?
It is pure conjecture, I must say, right. We don't have these solutions yet. So in this case, I would be just thinking about, this is just basically quantum mechanics in this case. Like doing instantons in quantum mechanics. Yeah, but I don't have these solutions explicit. Right, this is up to now conjecture. Thank you. Very good. So let us just, go on and try just to compare the fractional instantons with the BPST instantons and see what happens. So the fractional instantons or the amplitude of the fractional instanton is governed by the three actions, S3, S2, and S1. And these actions are proportional to the topological charges, as I mentioned. And we want to compare this sum of actions with the BPST instanton action at this length L of T3. And you see that these actions depend on the coupling constants G3, G2, and G1 of the SU3, SU2, and G1 hyper at the length scale L. So what actually we need to do is just we have to start from the weak scale, which is defined by the mass of the Z particle, and run up all the way to some very high scale L, or inverse L. So I'm just going to use my RG equations with general number of families and the Higgs doublet. And to be more specific, I run this exercise for NF equal to 3 and NH equal to 1. This is just our standard model. And let us now see what we get. We actually find that this critical L at which the fractional instantons will be more important than the BPST one is super Planckian. These are extremely bad news, unfortunately. One can understand this result because of the following. These fractional instantons depend on exciting the action of the S1 action, the U1 hyperaction, which is basically proportional to 1 over G1 squared, but G1 is extremely, extremely small, which makes the actions S1 extremely large. So in order for this action to compete with the action of the BPST instanton, you have to really go to extremely, extremely high energies, such that the G1 become really, really large, such that the action S1 becomes small. In other words, if you allow extra matter that is charged under U1 hyper, then you can actually bring L-1 critical below the Planck scale. So this is basically telling us that these fractional instantons are hopeless unless we have some extra U1 hyper matter. All right, in the last slide, let me just very briefly now comment on cosmology. So the problem is actually we have just discussed that all these solutions are non-localized solutions. These solutions are constant on T3. So one might think maybe these instantons could have played an important role in the early universe, given that our universe lives on T3, but does our universe really live on T3? The answer is maybe. The CMP analysis actually is telling us that if we live on a torus, then this torus size has to be a little bit bigger than the observed horizon of our universe, which is around 12 gigabarsec or so today. But let us go back in time and see whether there was any point in time at which the size of the torus was inside the horizon. If this is the case, maybe then we can make sense of this fractional instantons, given that there is some extra hyper charged matter and that make these fractional instantons important. Simple analysis, during the radiation dominated era in the universe, is telling us that the radius of the T3 was always bigger than the radius of the horizon, which means that making use of these instantons, as Maxim was saying, actually is very problematic. Unless there is some other cutoff scale that basically trims or becomes responsible for trimming the size of these fractional instantons, which up to now is unknown. All right, so let me actually, because I started with the take home message, let me end with the to-do list. If we want to like push this paradigm or push this project forward actually, then the first thing we might want to look for solutions on T3 cross R, which is I think important. Maybe even if we cannot find an analytical solution, maybe we have to go and seek the help of the lattice. Also, I all my solutions were found with the zero Higgs-Bib. One might wonder whether actually turning on the Higgs-Bib might buy us something. Maybe the Higgs-Bib somehow will localize the solution. We don't know. So this is the third point here that I want to make, I want to emphasize, that maybe we should really be more like optimistic about finding such localized solutions. But then you might ask where the localization will come from. You have to introduce some extra scale beyond the scale of the T3 or the T4. And this might be a strong coupling scale or maybe the Higgs-Bib or maybe in the horizon. I must say that we don't know yet. Maybe I just should leave it to here. Thank you.
Thank you, Mohamed. Do people have questions?
Yes, I just have a question about the application again. So
right.
Let's say that you find these solutions and then that you'll have these baryon and lepton number violating processes occurring in the early universe above the electroweak phase transition.
Right.
What's going to be different from the usual story with electroweak phalerons?
Oh, very good question. Thank you. I thought a little bit about that. One immediate thing that comes to my mind then is the following. Okay, so I mean, if you are above the electroweak scale, one can argue that in general you can. Oh, sorry. I don't know how to write. Maybe it should be, sorry, just use that instead. So you see actually in the, I mean, in the BPST instanton, one can actually think of, okay, so I don't know what is happening, just, yeah, it is here. This is better, sorry for that. So I mean, well, actually, so if you have like QQQL from the BBST, one can think of some effective processes by which you actually convert three quarks into one lepton as an effective vertex. Here in this case, actually, you will have so many zero mods. So in some sense, actually, this is going to be a more efficient process than the normal BBST instanton process. So a BBST actually gives you, for example, delta B equal to one per family. Here, actually, you have bigger delta B. Actually, it is actually even thought, yeah, I think it is even here. Actually, if you can see here, delta B for these fractional instantons, first of all, depends on the gauge group that you, so it depends on the, on whether actually you get Z6 or Z3 or Z2. So for example, for the case of Z6, you find actually that it is three times the number of the families. So for three families, you actually get nine, delta B equal to nine.
Okay, but let me, okay, but normally when we have electroweak phalerons, right? You take the B minus L gets converted into a B, right? There's an expression, you use the chemical potentials.
Right. Exactly.
And B
exactly.
Is some fraction. I forgot what it was. 34/79 B minus L. Right.
Right.
You saying that if you have these other baryon number violating processes, that coefficient is just going to be different? That's all.
Exactly. Exactly. That's correct. Yes.
But yeah, I see. But will that help? I guess that might help generate a baryon asymmetry at the electroweak scale. Is that the idea then?
That is correct, yes.
I see.
Yeah, but the devil is in the details because as you see, we need some very large number of extra matter that is chosen under U1 hyper. And also we have to make sense of these solutions on T3 cross R as well.
Mm-hmm. I see.
So I have a lot of questions. I'm going to try to hold them in case anybody has other questions.
Can I also ask a question about the ground unified theory a bit more?
Yeah, please, go ahead.
So you said that if you assume there is a gap, then the global symmetry, global Z6 symmetry is broken. So does it mean that you cannot gauge the symmetry if you have the gap in the UV?
Yes, that is correct. So if just I assume gut, then Z6 doesn't is explicitly broken, and I cannot gauge it.
Okay, so that means that if you somehow find, I don't know, fractional instanton somewhere like in the universe, then that sort of falsifies the ground unified theory. Am I correct?
Well, I don't know what it means to find fractional instantons, but. A simpler thing actually to find is to find a particle, a heavy particle that actually breaks the Z6 explicitly.
Yeah.
So for example, go ahead.
Before we go down this road, I think I want to make a remark. I just looked at the paper by David Tong that discussed some of these things, not all of them, earlier in 2017. And in that paper, it is stated that you can only embed the standard model gauge group in SU5 if you gauge the Z6, meaning that in the grand unified theory based on SU5, the Z6 is gauged automatically. It is not the case that this one form symmetry is explicitly broken. It is gauged
in grand unified models, according to that remark. Now, maybe that remark is wrong, or maybe I'm reading it wrong, but I wanted to bring this up because somehow the stakes of this question have just increased, right?
But very interesting. But then how, I must say that I don't understand that what does mean actually to have, because it is assumed that we have SU5, right?
Say that again?
SU5, okay, let's assume that SU5, grand unified theory, for example.
Yeah.
Okay, where Z6 where you will find the Z6 there?
So,
because the center of SU5 is Z5. So I must be missing
It's related to the symmetry breaking pattern. There's some effectively ambiguity in the symmetry breaking pattern, which is part of a gauge transformation in the full theory. I think that's what he means, but I'm just almost I'm basically quoting his footnote one, whatever that's worth. I mean, more specifically, he calls the gauging the group that you gauge by gamma, and the statement is, and I quote, "The theoretical prejudice of unification suggests that gamma is equal to Z6, since only then is the standard model gauge group a subgroup of SU5 or spin 10.
But does this mean that the SU5, okay, in SU5 you can gauge a Z6?
No, I think it's automatically gauged.
Automatically gauged.
The Z6 of the standard model is automatically gauged. I think that's what he
means. Oh, I see. You are telling me that
the way that you embed the standard model.
You are telling me SU5, okay. Because you are telling me that actually that the low energy gate subgroup of SU5 is SU3 cross SU2 cross SU1 mod Z6.
That's what I'm claiming. That's what I'm saying. That's what I think David Tong is claiming. This is not my claim, but this is what he's claiming. And I think I've seen other people say this too, for whatever that's worth. Now, this doesn't take away from anything that you've said, because it means that precisely in this case, you should, to the extent you're working with SM fields, you should find these weird fractional instantons. It's very interesting.
Yeah, so basically, Alexei, what you're saying is that these fractional instanton solutions, they should exist even with SU5, right? Because now there's B2 fields, they should exist in the full grand unified theory.
Perhaps, yeah, and I'm a little bit confused about this. I have a related remark or maybe question.
Okay.
Like, suppose that this was early 70s before people discovered explicit instanton solutions, but maybe people back then were unusually prescient and they thought about what could the solutions look like. And you write down the Yang-Mills equation. You have no idea how to solve it, but you observe that there is a topological charge and there's a BPS condition. And you notice that the equations are scale invariant, translationally invariant, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. Like from this, you can immediately conclude that any classical solution, in particular a BPS classical solution, must have a scale modulus because of the symmetries of the equation, and must have translation moduli.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And you should expect a solution for any given value of the topological charge. And in fact, this is all true, right?
Okay.
Like, we know that there's the DHM solution for the most general case, et cetera, for BPS solution.
Okay.
But that only came later. Now, in this case, imagine that there's no Higgs web turned on. Then actually, all of the equations are also the classical equations of motion, the BPS equations, everything is scale invariant.
But sorry,
but wait a minute. But we are in T4 here.
Yeah, I was going to say.
No. Don't. Yeah. So I'm saying, do not do that.
Yeah. Because Alexei, obviously,
don't do that. Yeah.
On T4, you don't have these symmetries, right?
So that's right.
So you're.
That's right. So don't do that. Yeah, I'm saying don't do that. Yes. Don't work on T4.
So just think of R4. Okay.
Exactly. R4 with the appropriate boundary conditions so that, you know, it makes sense to solve the equations with a given topological charge.
Okay.
Then, given that the equations are scale invariant, any solution must have a scale modulus, any classical solution. Any solution must have a translation modulus, actually, in fact, if it's really an instanton solution and so on. Now, I think once you observe that, you know, just on a formal level, the topological charge in these particular rather subtle gauge theories is quantized in units of whatever, a third or two thirds of the usual one. It is a very natural conjecture that there should be solutions of the classical equations of motion that realize each topological charge. In fact, it would be utterly shocking if such solutions did not exist, but to me at least. But if they do exist, then they must have scale moduli. And then you can take any given solution in R4, and you can use method of images to construct solutions on tori. And some of them may be the ones that have been found by Tuft and others and by you. Others may be very different and look more localized. I'm not saying I know how to do this. I don't know how to solve these equations, but what I'm saying is I think that it's very plausible that they have nice solutions on R4 that in fact have scale moduli.
It is not crazy, but I must say, if they exist, they have to be extremely high non-trivial ones, because they know that people tried actually very hard back in the 80s, and their trials were not successful. So it's not easy. So I don't say that they don't exist, but if they exist, okay.
But I think in the 80s, people had no chance because, you know, for what I'm saying, you want to work on R4. And if you want to work on R4, now you need to understand what it means to gauge a discrete symmetry, moreover, one form, whatever symmetry, on R4. And this was not understood in the 80s at all, as far as I know. And it's only been understood in the last few years. Right. So
yes.
I think in the 80s had no chance. They had no chance.
But by the way, Lexi, you're talking about self-dual solutions here, right?
I am. Although I think, I mean,
because as you know, right? There's the meron, right? The meron has a topological charge 1/2, right? So
right. But the merons are not particularly good. Calling them solutions is perhaps giving them too much credit, right? They don't really solve the equation.
They solve the equation, right?
Do they? They're not continuous. They have some diseases, right?
They solve the Yang-Mills equation, right? I mean, you can find the solution.
But they are singular.
They're very singular, yeah.
Well, they have zero size, but okay.
Right. So saying that they solve the equation is a strong statement. Yeah, I'm not sure they do. I mean, they are an interesting thing to think about, but they're not in the same category.
Okay, you're proposing that there are other fractional solutions which are actually regular and have a size and they behave BPST instantons.
Exactly. In this class of gauge theory with this gauged symmetry, this gauge discrete symmetry. And you know, until you have a nice continuum formulation of such theories, which until recently did not exist, as far as I know. I don't know how you would look for it.
But I mean, you see, Alexei, actually, all these constructions, recent constructions, they are making use of the QFT, all right? So these are great in order to understand what is really going on, but none of these constructions or mathematical constructions looked at what could be this fractional things, right?
I completely agree. It's not been done, yeah.
Yes, so, and it is not immediately clear how they can help, I must say as well.
Right. I have nothing to say about that. I wish I did. I think it's a very interesting question, but I don't know how to do it. I'm just saying, if you forget some of the details for a second and just like think of it in the same language as you could have thought in the 70s, if only you had the right perspective. It's very tempting to think that the right thing to do is formulate things in R4 and then proceed.
Yeah, but basically you're arguing that these continuous solutions should exist because now we've uncovered these higher forms, this one form symmetry, which is gauged, right? It's the gauging of the higher form symmetry suggests that these solutions exist, that's what you're saying.
Exactly, that's what I'm saying. And if they actually exist, I think if they're localized, it could be really cool because one of your observations, Mohamed, right, is if you take the BPS ones, since they have fractional topological charge, they also have a smaller action than the usual instantons.
Right.
Hence, they're more important all things being equal, and they have different zero modes. So
that's correct.
You know, finding them is actually potentially really important because it could have all sorts of phenomenological implications.
I agree with you 100%, especially in the very early universe. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I mean, but how, this is really the big question.
Oh, yeah. This motivates a non-trivial question in mathematical physics, which is how to find these instanton solutions. Have you talked, now you're in Durham, so you have people who spend their lives looking for weird BPS solutions, like Richard Ward, who might be retired now, but then many, many others in the math department.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Have you tried talking to them about this stuff? I mean, I would guess they'd get really excited about it if they heard about it.
Well, yeah, kind of, yeah, but we haven't brainstorm much about what these things could be or how to proceed. Okay, I mean, yeah, I mean, people can construct them on T4 quite easily, as I mentioned. But right. Once you just depart from T4, things become really ugly.
Okay, but I would guess that Durham would be like one of the best places in the world to try to figure this out because of the group there, specifically the people who work on ADHM right. constructions and related things.
Right.
I mean, that's one of right. the centers for this.
Right.
Very interesting. I'm sorry, I have one more question, which might be
Please.
When you gauge these symmetries, you also get some new theta terms, right? You get some discrete theta terms that you could add to the theory. Have you thought about that at all?
Not really. No, I didn't think about that. But okay, so what you are proposing about, because I mean, here I'm assuming that, at least when I constructed my solutions, I'm assuming that the Higgs is dev. So if all the particles have zero mass,
mm-hmm.
but still you are actually saying that there are some discrete, I see what you mean.
In the TQFT discussion, there are like two form gauge fields and you could call them B2 or something. So you could take B2 wedge B2, that's a nice four form, you could integrate it on space-time, and then the thing you put in front is quantized, but you could choose what is there.
I see.
A discrete theta term of some sort.
I see what you mean.
I don't know what it's good for in this context, but
yeah. Yeah, it's a good question. I don't know whether actually these things play any role in the standard model. Yeah, it's not clear to me. So let me try to understand what you are saying better. So let's talk about specific examples. So let's take, for example, the SUN, QCD adjoint or super young mills. Mm-hmm. So by the discrete angle, I am thinking about SUN mod Z n, for example, and there are so many different theories, the sub Q, where Q is from 0 to n-1, right?
Correct.
These are, and you are telling me actually whether there is something similar to that in the standard model. And I must say, yes, in principle, but I don't know how to construct them with my explicit solutions yet. Yeah, this is a good point.
Okay, good. That's exactly what I was referring to. Okay.
Yes.
In order to gauge that Z6, you needed to introduce three two-form gauge topological.
That's correct,
right?
Yes.
So
yes.
You can write down some probably complicated topological terms. It's not obvious to me, I guess, that you get one discrete theta angle.
Oh, I see.
Or that it's so simple, but I don't know. Yeah.
Maybe you have more, but if you have more, it's also interesting, right?
Yes, definitely. But I haven't thought about how we can actually do that. Thanks for the remark.
But the Tachikawa, Yuji Tachikawa's papers on gauging symmetries and what the fact that you get certain -1-form symmetries when you gauge, say, mm-hmm. one-form mm-hmm. symmetry, it suggests that there should be discrete theta parameters in your. I think so.
That is correct.
Very cool stuff. Does anybody have any more questions or remarks?